joining me on the latest episode of the Gray Area Podcast. Be sure to subscribe to our YouTube channel at Kevin Gray Sports and subscribe to our podcast on Apple Podcasts and wherever you get your podcasts for free. I am joined by the founder of the JumpBall.net, NBA reporter for Bleacher Report, and the Athletic NBA show on the Athletic NBA. You can find him on Twitter at Mo Dakhil _NBA. Mo Dakhil joining me on the program. Mo, how are you?
I'm doing great, man. I'm doing great. By the way, nothing works more perfectly than the name of your show. I mean, Kevin Gray, and then you get to go straight into the gray area for
That's
your
right.
show. I was just thinking about it as you're doing the intro, and I was like, damn, I'm kind of jealous.
Well, I appreciate that. You know, it takes a lot of creative juices to be like, you know what? Maybe I should just use my last name.
I don't think people understand how hard it is sometimes to come up with a good name.
No, I understand. In full transparency, I got some help from some folks on Twitter. I put up a little poll. I was like, hey, here's a few names I'm thinking of. What do you think? And I was thinking the gray area, and then most folks agree with this. Like, okay, cool. Then my mind had me going in the right direction. So,
well, if you want a funny story, before my website, the Jump Ball, was the Jump Ball, it literally started out as Mo's B-Ball Blog, because I didn't know anything better to do that. And then one of my friends is like, calls me and says, yo, listen, I'm all for you trying to get into this media game. That cannot be the name. That website name needs to change, and it needs to change today. And I was like, oh, okay.
That's terrific. Well, it looks like it's working. It's working because you do a terrific job covering this league. The Athletic NBA show, their most recent episode, Dave Dufour, Seth Partnow, and Mo Dakhil go through their awards picks for the NBA season. And as we kind of jump into this, obviously an exciting season for the folks down here in Dallas, and Luka Doncic, of course, the young superstar for this team. And I'm interested because you had a very nice coach of the year pick for the folks in Dallas, and one Rick Carlisle. Tell me why Rick Carlisle at this point in his career is still the right coach for this basketball team, especially all the things that he has gone through and now on the cusp of potentially having a championship contender now.
Well, one, he's ultimately respected across the NBA, from coaches to media, across the board. Like, he just has all that respect right away off the bat. He's a great coach. We all know him as a very good X's and O's coach. I know from my days as a video coordinator, you know, having to scout his teams, always prepared, always ready to go. And they always fight. And I think this is a very good year for the Mavs. I mean, listen, last year, let's just be honest, I didn't have them making the playoffs. I had them fighting for a playoff spot. Nobody expected Luka to make that massive leap that he made. And, you know, being able to go through everything they did, and they had adversity, you know, Dwight Powell going down with the Achilles early on and things like that. You know, they were able to just kind of deal with everything and continue to go. And they really pushed the Clippers in that first round playoff series. So, you know, I don't expect, and this is going to probably get me some trouble with some fans, I don't expect Luka to make as big a leap this year, just because I don't think there was enough time between the season ending and the season starting, and enough time to, I call it getting back into the lab, you know, and start working on your game. So I wouldn't be shocked. Now, let's just be honest, if he plays the way he played last year, still pretty damn good. Yeah. But I think with Rick Carlisle, I think, you know, if the Mavs can jump and be the third seed in the West, I think that third seed's wide open. And I think if they can jump in there and be that, I think the narrative and the story behind everything, which goes into some of these awards, fair or unfair, I think that plays well for Rick Carlisle. And I think it's something that, you know, he's got a really good chance of winning it.
Yeah. And you guys were kind of talking about it, and I tend to agree with it. A lot of these awards are really narrative based awards. When you start thinking about certain storylines going into the year for certain players and coaches, given their circumstances from a year or two before and what that does going into a new season. And you mentioned Luka Doncic and the leap that he may not necessarily be able to take just because of the shortened time frame of coming out of the bubble and starting a new season. Were you surprised at the leap that he made from year one to year two, and going from not just a rookie of the year, but to a first team all NBA performer and an odds on favorite to win an MVP this year?
Yeah. And if anybody says no, they were expecting this, they're a flat out liar, Kevin. Like, I don't think the Mavs had that expectation. You know, he just kind of took it to another level. And the thing is, and this is something that's interesting, is it sustained all year, right? Like, we've seen guys come out and have a great first month of the season, great 2 months, and we're all like, wow, that dude's, MVP-type caliber guy. He's going to be a contender for the award, and then slowly kind of fades off. That wasn't the case. Luka was balling all year long, raised everybody's eyebrows. You know, everybody was paying attention and like, damn, this kid can hoop. So, you know, it was surprising. And I was a huge Luka fan before he got drafted. Like, yeah, in that draft, I was like, anybody who picks, who doesn't pick Luka number one is stupid. You know, like, that's a big, massive mistake. I don't care what your team, who you have on your team, it's just dumb if you didn't pick Luka number one. And it is stupid that he ended up going all the way to third, right? And then the Hawks made that trade. I just look at it going like, that was a mistake by, you know, those three teams that all passed on him. And, you know, I was shocked he was an MVP caliber player in his second year. I thought that was something that might come in like his, you know, fourth year type situation. But, yeah, you know, he's there now, and now it's about building and continuing to improve upon that and him not being complacent with just being where he's at.
Mm-hmm. And at 21 years of age, has put himself on that short list as one of the 5-10 best players in the league going into this year. And a lot of folks have a lot of questions about his running mate. So Kristaps Porzingis, dealing with a meniscus tear, is expected to come back at some point in January. When you look at Kristaps Porzingis in his game and some of the health issues that he's dealt with throughout his career, do you think he can be the second best player on a championship team as this roster is constructed currently for the Dallas Mavericks and Rick Carlisle?
That's a tough question because it's a health-related question. You know, he has the talent to be. That's not the thing in question. It's can he just stay healthy? Like, it's really been a tough run, right? Like, he went 18 months without playing, came back, you know, was balling, looked really good last year. There were games when Luka didn't play, but he was killing it. Mm-hmm. And, you know, so he definitely has that ability. It's just going to come down to health, and there's no way to predict that, you know, and it is scary that he continues to have, you know, these knee issues. And I think, you know, this is something that I'm always worried about, these big 7'3 guys, you know, or, you know, anybody 7'1 and above. Granted, I don't ever have to worry about that for me. But like, those guys and their legs seem to always kind of be an issue. And so I have concerns about that, but talent wise, he definitely could be the number two option on a championship team. And he fits so well with Luka and what the Mavs are building right now. I mean, even with a healthy Dwight Powell, who can spread the floor a little bit, but using him as a vertical spacer on those roles really opens up, you know, the kickouts to Porzingis when Luka drives. And I think that's an important thing there. And it works well together. So I think ultimately, you know, he's going to be a great option, assuming he can stay healthy.
Yeah, and as he continues to deal with his health and coming back, hopefully for Mavs fans at the beginning, at some point in January, this team has made some additions and some subtractions. Seth Curry going to Philadelphia in exchange for Josh Richardson. They've also added James Johnson. They drafted Josh Green at number 18. What do you think about the overall roster construction and how they've assembled this team around Luka Doncic and Kristaps Porzingis and trying to make much more efforts on the defensive end to be better than what they were last year in terms of being 18th in defensive efficiency a year ago?
Yeah, I loved the Seth Curry for Josh Richardson trade, and I loved it for both teams. It was one of those times where I was like, this is a win-win for both teams. Makes too much sense. You know, it sometimes it makes so much sense, I'm shocked it happened. kind of trade. But, you know, when you look at what Josh Richardson brings, you know, if you just look at what he did in Philly, that's a tough deal. He never really fit. It was that whole team had a difficult situation. But what he'll bring to Dallas is the ability offensively to kind of help with the ball handling and playmaking. He can allow Luka to play a little bit off the ball, which is the same stuff that Seth, what he's not the shooter Seth Curry is. Like, I don't think that's even close, right? Like, he shot the lights out of the ball.
Yeah.
But he's a much better defender, and that's something you're going to need with a guy like Luka, who's not that great defensively, and they need to add more perimeter defense and things like that, especially in the West when you have a bunch of point guards you're going to have to defend every night. You have a bunch of wings you have to defend on a nightly basis. So I think just continuing to add that kind of defensive depth is going to be really important for the Mavs moving forward. And I like what they've done so far this offseason. I think they're in a good situation to continue to get those guys. Because I think here's the thing. Guys are going to want to play with Luka.
Yeah.
And I don't think people understand sometimes how much that matters in free agency. You know, like, there's This might get me a little bit of trouble with some Laker fans here, but you know, there was a run where guys just didn't want to play with Kobe. Right. Mm. And whatever, you could say fair, unfair, whatnot, but it was true. Just guys just were like, he's really hard to play with. He's very demanding. It's very tough and things like that. And it became an issue. I think you see that sometimes with guys like with James Harden. I think we're going to find more and more guys aren't going to want to play with him. I think this is going to be a thing, but with Luka, guys want to play with him. Like guys wanted to play with Steve Nash back in the day, mm-hmm. like guys want to play with LeBron. They know that that kind of player is going to raise their value and help them in the long run. And I think that ultimately matters a ton. And I think that's a positive thing as this team continues to build.
Do you think Luka Doncic can change that narrative and that belief that a lot of folks think that Dallas doesn't attract the kind of big name free agents to come there? Can Luka change that perception of Dallas? And why do you think that is, that major free agents haven't flocked to Dallas in that way?
Yeah, it's interesting. You know, I think I don't even know who their biggest free agent signing is off the top of my head. Like, and that's kind of the thing. There's always just teams that just for whatever reason don't want to. Dallas seems like I've been there a few times, not a lot. So I haven't spent a ton of time there, but seems like a great city to live in. But ultimately you have such great ownership with Mark Cuban. Like it should be a much more attractive than it is. And I think Luka will help with that. You know, I think for the other thing that was kind of difficult was the run of Dirk towards the end. It just felt like everything was geared towards, we're just going to give Dirk a great send off. And I think that might have pushed some guys off a little bit. You know, it's like, how much are they really going to compete? And I think the thing now with Luka, 21, going to be in the MVP conversations, knock on wood, he stays healthy for a long career. You know, he's going to be in there for the next 10 years in the MVP conversation, right? If everything goes according to plan, he may not, I don't think he's going to win 10 straight, but like he's going to win a couple, you know, and it's going to be something that's going to bring those guys that are going to want to come and play. I think ultimately, he will help change that narrative, and it helps. They have one of the best owners in the league, you know, a great fan base. You know, and the way things are structured now, you can be a star anywhere. This isn't the old days.
Yeah.
This isn't the 90s where it was like you're only a star if you're in L.A., if you're in New York, Chicago, you know, like the few cities. This is, you know, like guys are going to have commercials everywhere. It's easier now. So I think ultimately they'll be fine in that long run because, again, they got this shiny new toy.
Yeah.
And Luka, that's like, this is exciting and this is going to be great. And, you know, they'll get more national TV games. They'll be on a lot on ESPN, on TNT. You know, they'll be on primetime so much that people are going to want to come in and play there.
Yeah. I think the Mavericks will be on national television. They'll be 15 or 16 times in the first half of this year, including, of course, on Christmas Day. So a lot of folks will get a chance to see this team in the national spotlight. And before we kind of move toward the East and the West overall kind of preview, where do you think the Mavericks fit in terms of the upper echelon of the Western Conference? Is this a team that can crack the top four and be, you know, in that maybe second tier behind the Lakers and the Clippers? Can they fit in that top four of the Western Conference this year?
I think so. It's just funny. You know, I have at least five teams every day in that third spot. So it's like, you know, it's just a rotating cast of characters. But they're right there, you know, and I think they are a top four team in the West. I'm really high on what they did by bringing in Josh Richardson. I thought that was a sneaky good move for them. And, you know, they're getting back guys who I love for, you know, just for dumb reasons, like Jalen Brunson always just makes plays.
Yeah.
You know, he just always somehow makes the right play. And I love that. And I think that's an asset for the team, a way that's going to continue to help build them up. And I think, you know, they're right there. It's going to be – this season's kind of crazy, Kevin, because you have to look at it in the sense of there is an unknown thing there that we have no idea what's going to happen in terms of COVID.
Mm-hmm.
We don't know. There could be a really good team. The Lakers, for whatever reason, could be knocked out for 2 weeks if, you know, a couple of guys get COVID. You know, it's a whole – that whole other – that thing out there, that elephant in the room, it's there. We can't forget about it. And it's going to have some sort of effect on the season, and it's going to crush a few teams unfairly. And I think that's just the reality of it. So, you know, this is kind of really an up in the air thing. It's hard to pinpoint strictly. Like, I see all these guys doing their projections and I'm sure I'm going to do one soon too, but it's like, man, this is just one of those years. I don't want to predict anything.
No, I understand, because I think that is the biggest element that could derail not only this for specific teams, but for the league in whole, after having so much success with the bubble down there, not having any positive COVID-19 tests. How are you feeling about how the NBA is approaching it with their 158-page protocols that they have as far as this is concerned? How are you feeling about how this league is approaching this going into the season where there is going to be no bubble this year?
I mean, it was impossible, I think, to really do a bubble, like, you know, for a regular season. When people are talking about, like, I can't believe they're doing this without the bubble, I'm like, do you guys think that you can get 30 teams, 450 players in the bubble and keep them contained? Like, it's easier to do that for a shortened season, for finishing a season in playoffs, but you want to do that for a whole season, like, good luck with that. These guys, they struggled. There was a struggle in the bubble that probably doesn't get talked about enough is the mental strength it took, you know, and anybody who cracked, you know, there's nothing wrong with that. We're all cracking now. Like, I'm going a little bit crazy in my house. So it's not like, you know, it's not shocking or abnormal, but I just think the NBA more than any other league, I feel like, cares the most about their players as people. And I think they work really well with the Players Association. I think both parties are understanding of this is unprecedented times. We have to figure everything out as we're going, and we're kind of in uncharted territory. So I think, you know, it's not going to be perfect like the way the bubble was, which I didn't even expect the bubble to work out the way it did. Right. You know, but like, I think they're taking it very serious. And I think that's the thing I appreciate. But also at the same time, it does seem kind of crazy that we're at the craziest point right now in the pandemic in terms of the numbers, and the season's going to start in less than a week. So I think there is a little bit of like, all right, well, what are we doing here?
Yeah.
Kind of thing. I understand it and all that stuff. And believe me, I benefit from it. You know, so it's something I'm going to have to live with for a bit, but everybody seems to be on board. And if long as everybody, the players, the coaches, the staffs all take it serious, I think they'll be okay. I wouldn't say they'd be all right. They'll be okay.
Yeah, no, I agree, because, you know, you look at leagues like the NFL, at times it feels like the NFL is just plowing through this thing as the best they can just to, you know, get a season done, while the NBA, it appears they're taking much more care and much more precaution based on the ability to do this safely. And the NBA seems to be a model in that front. And as we kind of
I mean, just to go real, like, the NFL is the way you say it, just plowing through it. You know, it's literally like, okay, this team doesn't have their offensive line tonight.
Or in the case of the Denver Broncos, we don't have a quarterback.
They didn't have a quarterback. You know, they moved the Ravens Steelers games 15 different times. You know, right. It was like they are trying to bend, not break, but they are basically going full board with every, like, they are just not hesitating at all. Mm-hmm. And, you know, right or wrong, whatever, it's not for me to judge that stuff. I just appreciate that the NBA, I feel like, has taken a little more time and put a little more care into everything they're trying to do.
No, I definitely agree. And as we look at the overall NBA preview, we'll start in the Western Conference, because, of course, that's where the defending champion Los Angeles Lakers reside, and you reside in LA. And the feeling around the Lakers and the Clippers, obviously two very different seasons that finished out for them as far as the Lakers becoming champions and all the rumored chemistry issues that the Clippers apparently dealt with during this season. Are those the two prohibitive favorites in the Western Conference, given what their team makeups are, even though that's changed a little bit, even with a little, you know, LA on LA crime with Montrezl Harrell going to the Lakers this year?
Yeah, I think, look, here's the thing. The Lakers got better, plain and simple. They may have sacrificed a little bit of defense, but overall they got better and they got younger. And I think that's positive for them. The Clippers, I think, improved their chances of a better locker room. You know, like, I'm one of the ones that was like, yeah, I kind of felt it early on. I said, this team's not going to have the chemistry they need. I felt like there were issues there. And I feel like that's where the Serge Ibaka signing comes in. I think he does a great job of keeping the locker room light.
Yeah.
Keeping everybody happy. And then because he has a past history with Kawhi Leonard, keeping Kawhi engaged, because I think that was their biggest problem, was Kawhi wasn't really engaged last season. You know, the stories, living in San Diego and commuting, showing up to the plane late and things like that and stuff, that's not engaged, you know, and that's not being a leader. Now, he's never really had to lead on any of the teams he was on before, but he came to the Clippers and they were expecting him to lead, and that's not leadership type things you do. And I think that's an issue there. And I don't want to kill him for living in San Diego. I mean, I know of players that live in New York and played in Philly. So it's not like, you know, and we're doing the commute and stuff. But mm-hmm. if you're doing that, you have to appropriately make sure you're on time. You have to make sure that's not a problem for the team and the organization. And I don't think he did. And I think, you know, again, I think where Serge Ibaka comes in, kind of keeps him a little more engaged. I mean, look, the dude was on Jimmy Kimmel.
That's true. Like,
Kawhi was on Jimmy. That was the most I've ever seen him speak.
That's true.
You know, like,
he was kind of funny too, actually.
Yeah, he's like, it was like it's a lighter Kawhi. I mean, I'm joking yeah. with friends of mine. I said, man, Kawhi played all three preseason games for the Clippers. Yeah. That he didn't play that last year. That didn't happen last year.
Yeah.
You know, I think there's an element where it feels like Kawhi's more locked in. And, you know, I know everybody's killing the Clippers. It's the fun thing to do right now. But we can make all the jokes. They're still a damn good team. And they're going to be there, I think, right at the end. So they'll be there with the Lakers. But the Lakers definitely got better.
Yeah, it's interesting to see how Ty Lue, of course, he was LeBron James' head coach when they won that NBA championship back in 2016, defeating the Golden State Warriors in seven games, how he will manage these superstar personalities with Paul George and Kawhi Leonard, if he can remake that culture there. And speaking of cultures being remade, so we're going to switch our attention to the Eastern Conference in Philadelphia, because I don't know about you, but they just fascinate me as a team, as an organization, especially with this whole Daryl Morey, Doc Rivers mashup that they got going on out there. And of course, Ben Simmons, Joel Embiid, and those guys still there. Can this team figure it out and make it work to where they can become one of the top contenders in the Eastern Conference this year?
Kevin, this is the one team I can't quit, man. Like, I really try all the time. They piss me off so much. And I'm always like, no, that's – and my friends in my group chat kill me for it over and over again for it. It's my little basketball group chat. And they're just like, you know, we had a new guy join our chat. And I started talking about, like, I don't know, guys, Philly looks good. And one of them was like, Mo, you say this every year. Every year. That was the next five text messages were every year. Every year. And I was just like, damn it. They're right. Yeah. But I'm back in. Like, I don't I can't quit them. Yeah. They're too fascinating. It's amazing.
It's a narcotic, you know, that a lot of folks just can't quit.
Like, it really isn't. Like, you know, the one thing they can do that will make me quit is if they trade for James Harden. Because I think that's a mistake. And we'll get to that in just a second. But what they've done this offseason is, you know, they've given up probably the more talented players in trades, but have gotten back better fits. And that's the thing I like about this team is they're beginning to make sense. The past 2 years, that roster hasn't made a lot of sense. You know, they kept giving away shooting and bringing in another front court player. You know, it was like at one point they had like, gosh, I think they had around like $90 to $100 million tied up into their front court players. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, yeah, that's not enough for a backcourt. Like, you're not, you know, and then, and no shade to Shake Milton, but like, he's not the answer. Like, when they were talking about, like, well, we're going to move Shake Milton to the point guard in the bubble, I was like, that's not enough. That's not going to do anything. You know, but I like that they brought in Doc Rivers. I think Ben and Joel needed a change in the locker room, in the voice they kept hearing. And I think that's Doc. And I think Doc will do a good job of kind of going like, hey, we got to stop this nonsense and start hooping. Mm-hmm. I like Daryl Morey. I think he's a great fit for them in the sense of, again, he's going to make moves that make sense. He's not going to just do things and to do them or oh, that's a great player that we can just go get. Like, all right, we'll figure out the rest later. I think he understands the importance of fit. Now, people always talk about the Doc Rivers and Daryl Morey mashup, like it won't work. You know, they were in Boston together. You know, before Daryl left Houston, I mean, there are rumors that he was reaching out to Doc saying, would you have interest in this Houston, you know, job that opened up, you know, mm-hmm. and things like that. So I don't think it's something that wouldn't work. I just think, you know, it's actually going to be good for both of them. You know, yeah. both can learn from the other in terms of that and make them better at their jobs and things like that. And I like the stuff that, listen, Dwight Howard coming off the bench is a lob threat for them. It's a big man that can back up Joel Embiid. I think Joel Embiid needs to have a big year. I think Ben Simmons, you know, I think he has a chance to be Defensive Player of the Year. You know, I think they have two candidates for that with him and Joel.
Mm-hmm.
I really like this team. I don't know if they're a championship team. Part of me is just having been burned so many times in the past. Like I'm
you've trusted the process enough, haven't you?
Yeah, no, I'm kind of signing up, but like really kind of like, I can't believe I'm doing this again. It's like when I go after a PlayStation 5 these days, knowing I'm not going to get it. Like it's just more like, how are you guys going to burn me this time?
Yeah.
Sort of situation. And I think that's, you know, so I'm a little bit curious, but I think they can make it work. Cause I really do believe you can create an offense and a defense around Ben Simmons and Joel Embiid. I'm not one of these guys that thinks you can't make the two of them work together. Mm-hmm. I think they're unique talents, and I think there's a way to blend that. That said, if they trade for James Harden, I'm out.
That's it for you. You got to let it go.
It's done. That's it. We're moving on. And I don't think it's a trade that makes sense for either team.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when you look at the moves that they've made, you know, trading – Josh Richardson for Seth Curry to add more shooting, you know, Josh Richardson is the perfect player to play next to James Harden, you know, cause he's defensive and he can do some spot up stuff and do a mm-hmm. little bit with the ball. You know, I'm sure, you know, Harden would do well with Seth Curry, but ain't nobody playing defense in that backcourt, right. You know? And I think that's kind of the issues. Right. And I think those are the things that I'm curious about. And same thing with Houston. You just got John Wall. You're not going to be able to trade John Wall for the next 2 years with that mm-hmm. contract. So now your point guard and your – what I'm assuming is going to be your power forward, point forward in Ben Simmons. Now you have two guys that can't really shoot all that well. Like, that's a scary proposition there in that sense. So I'm not sure it makes sense for both teams. I understand why they would do it and all of that stuff. But I'm telling you, man, Sixers do that trade, I'm out.
Are you surprised how things have quickly deteriorated in Houston with James Harden and the way that the whole situation has gone down there?
A little bit. I think there's a lot of things I kind of don't like about it. You know, this is an organization that has bent over backwards for James Harden for 6 years. And that's part of the problem. You know, like that's, we all know our friends who have kids. I don't know how old you are, Kevin. I don't know if you have kids or not. Like, We all have friends, you know, who we see them raising their kid. I'm like, that's a spoiled little brat. You give them everything. You know, what's going to happen when you say no,
uh-huh.
you know, and that's kind of what happened with the Rockets. You know, they were bent over backwards for everything. You know, okay, you don't like Dwight Howard? Cool. Dwight's gone. You want Chris Paul? We're going to bring in Chris Paul. Oh, you want Chris Paul? Okay, cool. We're going to bring in your best friend, Russell Westbrook. Oh, Russ wants out. That's the more telling thing than anything else is Russell Westbrook, who when they first came in, you know, last year, it was all, we're friends, we're tight, we can talk to each other however we want. We're going to be able to make this work. We're the respect level's there already. We go way back. Russ made it a year and was like, yo, I'm done. That says a lot to me about him playing with Harden. And some of that was, you know, we've seen it in the story that Tim McMahon wrote for ESPN, you know, things of like him not being on time, him trying to just do everything everything was done at his level, at his pace. And the organization never really stood up and said no. And then, so now he's looking around going like, well, we're not a contender anymore. Trade me. Well, they're not a contender because of you.
Yeah.
Because of how you act. Now you're a hell of a player, MVP, you're in the conversation every year. This isn't taking away anything about that, but your style of play is extremely difficult to play with. And when we bring in guys to play with you, they end up not wanting to play that style.
Yeah.
And that's a problem. And now we need you to play a different style. And now you just want to leave because we're not a contender. Well, the reason we're not a contender is you. We made all these trades because you wanted these things. Look at, they gave up their draft equity for the next few years to get Russell Westbrook. Like you couldn't make it work. Like where are we? What are they supposed to do as an organization? I'm not shocked they went this way because we've all kind of heard the rumors of how mm-hmm. they were catering to him all the time and things like that. but it's a little bit disappointing. And I feel really bad for Steven Silas. Like, you know, here's a guy that's grinded for 20 years as an assistant coach trying to get his shot. He finally gets his shot. Long overdue, by the way. He should have gotten a shot several years ago in the league as a head coach. Yeah. There's no question he has the ability to do the job. And now he's got to deal with this. You know, first Russ wants to leave, and now James is sitting there, and James is doing a holdout the first week of camp and things like that. Even if you want to be traded, that's not he killed his trade value.
Yeah.
By doing that. I could have – there are teams out there that definitely were probably interested in James Harden, saw him at all these parties going like, yo, we can't really have this. Not now, not in the pandemic.
Yeah.
Like, what are you doing? Like, it's one thing if it's like, yo, I'm in Houston working out. I'm just not going to camp. All for that. But he's just showing like he's just going out of his way. And some people are saying you have to act that way to force the team's hands. Like, well, yeah, but at the same time, you just hurt your value. And now the team's in a situation where they're not going to get a lot for you.
Yeah.
It's just a tough spot in general. So I'm a little bit – I'm kind of disappointed in how it all played out.
Yeah. Last question before we get you out of here. This is going to be a very fun NBA season, granted, if things go the way that we hope they will with respect to everything going on in our world currently. Give me a team or two or a player or two that we aren't talking about right now that by the time we get to the end of, let's say, the first half of this season, that say, hey, we're going to need to talk about them going into the second half of this year.
Yeah, it's I think I brought it up on the Nerd or She Wrote podcast that you might have listened to already. Mm-hmm. The Damian Lillard's going to win the MVP to me. This is it. I think this is the prediction I'm going to make. I think Portland's in a great situation. I think Portland made a lot of moves. They've gotten better defensively. They've added versatility. And that's a big thing that I like. They're able to play multiple ways. They can go small. They can go big. Do I think they're going to win a championship? Probably not. but I think they're right in that top three mix in the West. Mm-hmm. You know, I think they're in that area where, you know, if everything goes right, you know, I think Dame's going to have a phenomenal year. You know, and he was amazing last year to carry that team. I mean, if that team was healthy, I think they would have been a top three team in the West. I think they would have edged out Denver. I think ultimately with Nurkic, who's gotten his legs under him in the bubble, he looks a lot better now and smoother. I think CJ is going to have a big year. I think Portland in general is going to be a team we're going to talk a lot about. And then you heard it here first, Kevin. Dame's winning the MVP.
Okay. Well, that's not going to make too many folks happy down here in Dallas because a lot of folks think
I know.
Luka's going to win the MVP, but, you know, I like the pick. I like the boldness of the pick, though. I like it.
Luka's young. You guys can relax, man. He's, you know, I'm sure there's going to be several more years of Luka, and I love him, man. He's got to stop crying to the ref, so
yeah,
he's got to stop.
I do agree with you there. Mo, tell the folks that they can find you on your social media and the work that you're doing as you get ready to cover this league yet for another season.
Yeah, you could find me on Twitter at Mo Dakhil, MoDakhil_NBA. Also on Instagram. Mostly Instagram is just me doing stupid stuff, so you may not be of any value to anybody whatsoever. But then I'm going to be writing for Bleacher Report. I believe I'm going to be in charge of the power rankings this year. So I'm sure I'll get nothing but hate mail now for the rest of the season. I'm not quite sure what I signed up for, but I'll be doing that there. You can listen to me on podcast on the Athletic NBA show, Nerd or She Wrote, every Friday. I'll be jumping on the Daily Ding a couple times a week, and I'm sure I'll be on other stuff. Easiest thing, just follow me on Twitter or Instagram, and I'm always posting the stuff I'm doing.
Mo does a terrific job covering this league. Very entertaining. Follow him and his guys over at the Nerd or She Wrote podcast. Do a terrific job also.
I'm the most entertaining one, Kevin. I'm the most entertaining one. Don't let the other ones tell you you're different.
Look, I'll take it. He's a former NBA video coordinator for the Los Angeles Clippers, San Antonio Spurs, and the Australian men's basketball team. Bleacher Report reporter and co-host of the Nerd or She Wrote podcast for the Athletic NBA show. You can follow him on Twitter at @MoDakhil_NBA. Mo Dakhil, good enough to join me on the program. Mo, thanks so much for the time. This is a lot of fun. We'll have to do this again sometime, man. Really appreciate it.
Anytime you want, Kevin. Thank you for having me.
Appreciate it.